Tides of Change, welcome to our special series of Tides of Change. My name is CGTN Zhao Yunfei, and welcome to our social media live stream on all platforms of CGTN. Now, we have come to perhaps second to the last day of Tides of Change. Now, at this point, we really want to give you a clue. We really want to give you a stake. Why we want to do a special series of Tides of Change? Certainly, we reflect how people's lives have changed over time due to China's deep sea exploration. But of course, what we want to tell you is how the history perspective that Chinese people have gone through. So today, in our special series, we'll talk more about the history. Now, today we certainly will cover speaking of South China Sea, you certainly will cover Hong Kong. But what makes Hong Kong a special place? And you know, it's governed by as a British colony for a period of time. So what's the history behind it? And we're gonna cover it today. But before we go through that, look at what's behind me, the Hulman Bridge. Just giving you a bigger perspective of the modernization of modern China. Certainly, this is the place where we would like to start our story. But let me introduce the place where we are, the curator. Lin Zexu, the curator of museum, Opium War Museum, Mr. Tang Lipeng. 唐馆长给我们介绍一下我们现在您所处的位置是什么样的一个位置? Where are we at?
We are now at the
old site of the Opium War, which used to be the battlefield, which is called Hulman Battery.
So he spoke about the Opium War. So that will really trace back to 1940s. In the 1939, there was an event happened about the opium. So what really happened was the British traders brought opium to the Chinese mainland, which has brought huge impact to the local people. So 您能给我们解释一下当时? 鸦片给我们中国的社会带来了怎样的一些打击? How the opium has affected?
From the end of 18th century, British opium was exported to China for a better profit. But this has brought a devastating effect to China. Many of the people, they are addicted to this drug, and they got broken. It takes a lot of money to buy opium. And which takes the capital to, which lead to the capital outflow, and which greatly harmed China's finance.
And definitely there is a huge deficit between the British outcome and the input here in China. And they're using a very extreme way to using a very dangerous drug to kind of put it into China, to drag into China. 那从中国人的角度上来考虑这件事情，把鸦片带到中国，这是一个非常的极端，或者是说从道义上非常不正确的一种做法。对，鸦片呢，当时
at that time, opium, especially in the Western world, led by the British, they came to seek a huge fortune. Of course, they know that there are some devastative effect on human body, but they are overwhelmed by their pursuit of fortune. To seek fortune, they are not afraid of braving some morality costs which bring about a lot of social damages to China.
So the government of Guangdong and Guangxi back then in the 1839 started a campaign to suppress opium. So that's what we call Hulman Xiaoyan. 给我们讲讲虎门硝烟的历史吧. Tell us more about the destruction of opium.
Because of the overuse of opium, the Chinese society suffered catastrophe. The Qing dynasty government has sent Lin Zexu as a special envoy to Guangdong province.
是一个非常廉政
He is a clean and serious official. When he came here, serious iron-faced approaches have been taken. British opium, some 2 million jin were destructed in Hunan. This is known as the opium destruction in Hunan.
And that's exactly an excuse of how the British invaders come to China. So that's why they started the Opium War. 那接下来我们讲就讲到虎门销烟的历史。这就是为什么 ，That's why where we are at. 这个场馆其实就是以虎门销烟的历史来建造的，是不是？啊，您能给我们带我们转一转吗？看看这边这个威海炮台这边是怎么样的一个设计的？
嗯，好。我们看一下我们当时这个炮台呢是鸦片战争的一个见证。
Is a witness of the Opium War.
我们首先从这边下嘛。
从这边下啊。那边呢 ?Can we go somewhere over there? 从那边下可以吗？
从这边下也可以。
可以从那边下。So actually, we can go down and take a look at the fort. And certainly, there is a big cannon over here. And the cannon is actually, well, it's being said, this cannon is, let's say, it's 100 years old. And it's part of the Opium War history. 这个大炮应该是真的吧？
这是真的。
This is a real cannon.
鸦片战争时期的大炮
which was used during the Opium War period.
销烟以后呢
？After the opium destruction, those traders suffered a lot financially.
他们就挑动他们本国
and they have incited their local government
对中国进行报复
to retaliate China
战争
and waged an opium war with China.
所以
this war is because of
在鸦片战争中
，It is named after opium. Therefore,
远征军到中国沿海进行侵犯。
British has sent troops to the coastal areas of China from the that sea area I pointed.
这个第二道防线。
This is our second defense.
当时那个虎门军
They invaded China in
奋勇抵抗。这门大炮就见证了当时
And this cannon was a great witness of the local bravery.
我们看这个大炮呢。
And as you can see, the cannon looks strong, but you take a deliberate look, it has a lot of dots on it, a lot of scars, because the steel making industry at that time was relatively low, and therefore you can see a cannon is relatively rough. This cannot stand still if they will be overheated because of a lot of because of the consecutive fire.
Okay, so I can give you. Let me give you a sense over here. So this big guy is actually pointing to the Zhujiang Estuary, and that's the entrance of Zhujiang Estuary. So if you go up, it's a go north alongside the river. It will go to the main cities here in Guangdong Province, and that's certainly a gate where foreign invaders will actually take advantage of and travel north, and so that it can travel far way beyond. And also, given the current construction, it's a very old ancient style construction. 您能给我们介绍一下现在我们所在的这样的一个位置是一个什么时期的一种建筑吗？是后期修复的，是不是？
我们这个炮台呢是在鸦片战争，时期就在这个炮台的
was applied during the Opium War.
鸦片战争时期炮台的旧址。
And this used to be the old site.
两次鸦片战争中，我们这个虎门炮台呢
during
受到了
those Opium Wars.
后来直到洋务运动时期
，this battery was destructed. And then fixed of China's self-motivated Western learning campaigns. But the site is still preserved.
And that's why we should always remembering what really happened in 1840s. 那接下来我们，您带我们上去吧。
好。
So we'll pave our way back, try to give you a bigger picture of what the Zhujiang Estuary looks like. Now, the reason why the Chinese Chinese history study trying to prove that the opium war is actually an excuse of how the invaders trying to open the market is because the Treaty of Nanking, because they one of the treaty is that to further open the ports here in China in order to open more opportunities, giving more opportunities to the British invaders. 我们讲一讲南京条约哈，为什么我们会说南这个鸦片战争或者说虎门销烟是一个借口，是或者是西方打开中国大门的一个借口呢？
因为这个我们。中国这个当时清朝
清了一
口通商政策，
那么就开始呢和英国
进行了这个贸易往来。
They have a lot of restrictions on foreign trade.
鸦片战争爆发前夕呢
，And they have opened treaty ports.
在这个两百多年之间呢，它并不是
During these two centuries, there are a lot of conflicts broke out between China and British government. The root of this conflict is because of internal colonial request to China, and they want to conquest China's raw material and market. The Qing dynasty, the institution at that time, was contradicted with their requests, and therefore, hot war broke out. From this aspect, the British colonists, they have been long wanted to use force to open China's gate of market. When it comes to the opium destruction in Hunan, it is only an excuse. They're using opium as a non-excuse to seriously wage a war of invasion to China. This war is a kind of conspiracy by the British army.
Just to give you a more idea, the treaty ports are being opened here in China are Guangzhou, Fujian, Shanghai, Ningbo, and Xiamen. But what makes it more worse is that the agreement also says that China should concede the islands of Hong Kong islands under the control of British control, and that's why Hong Kong was governed by British for a period of time. So a lot of Western media said that Hong Kong has been developed very well. So I really want to get reactions from our curator. 那您觉得很多人在市面上有一种说法认为，哎，香港现在发展的不错，那是南京条约造成的吗？
这个鸦片战争失败以后
the Opium War after its failure,
迫使当时的清政府签订了南京条约。
The Qing Dynasty government to sign up such an unequal treaty. This is the first unequal treaty signed up in the modern history of China. This is an unfair treaty, and we signed up for this by force. So, in this perspective, this is not fair, and it is a sign of invasion. In the treaty, there are a lot of unfair clauses. One of them is to concede Hong Kong Island. To the British government, and then it has been colonized by the United Kingdom. After a century, Hong Kong has become the pearl of the Orient. The reasons are varied. The most important reason is it is supported by the Chinese mainland, its sound market and abundant resources. They are perpetuators for its soaring economy, and of course, patriotic merchants, they have paid great contributions to the local prosperity.
但是您会怎么看待这个历史呢？就是how would you see how would the lesson we should learn today and the past, the modern history of China, and how would that current Chinese people reflect on that? Often given the current global situation, when there's conflict exists between some Western countries and China, what can we deal with the conflict? 从现在这个角度上来讲，我们是怎么启示到，或者说目前有一些西方国家跟中国依然有一些矛盾的存在，我们应该如何去调解这样的矛盾呢？
我们对鸦片战争这段历史
And speaking of this history, it has a great impact on Chinese people. To memorize this history, we want to memorize it from two aspects. First, domestically, speaking of Opium War, it is the opening chapter of China's modern history. It is a history of humiliation for Chinese people. A Chinese people was just but failed. A lesson we've learned is that lagging behind makes one vulnerable for foreign attacks. And we have seen the Qing dynasty cannons, and if you see a comparison between of the military muscle between the two countries, you will know that in a just fight, we've lost. This has inspired us. We have to rejuvenate our national defense and to safeguard our national gate, and also to advance our technology. This are the prerequisite for China's rise. Second, we are conveying a very sound message to the world. We want to better safeguard peace, and we are not spreading hatreds. We hope that countries can take history as a lesson to prevent war and to have more
peaceful coexistence. Well, of course, the history will continue. So our another group of reporter, Zhu Dan, is joining us live from Hong Kong. So she's going to tell how the history has developed from Hong Kong.
Tides of Change. And here in Hong Kong, I'm right now in the West Kowloon Cultural District, one of the world's class cultural districts in Hong Kong. And you know, lots of exhibitions, museum here in Hong Kong's West Kowloon Cultural District. I will show you later, because it has like Hong Kong Class Museum and Plus Museum. But first of all, we would like to talk about more about Hong Kong's history and future here. And in 1997, it was in Hong Kong Convention and Exhibition Center that held the handover ceremony from the British to China. First of all, I will introduce our first guest today. He has been living here over 40 years. He is the one, I trust that he knows more about Hong Kong's history than me. So he is Grenville Cross. He is also the former Chief Prosecutor of Hong Kong. Welcome, so thank you for coming today. So just now you've seen our live streaming of our reporter here in Guangdong, right? So it was in 1997 when Hong Kong returned to China. So you've been living here for over 40 years. Tell us about what's your experience. I mean, what's the difference between before 1997 and after 1997?
Well, you have to remember that the National People's Congress enacted the Basic Law in 1990, and one of the purposes of that was to ensure that Hong Kong's way of life and its capitalist system remained unchanged. So the whole emphasis was on continuity, on people's lives continuing very much as they did before. But that having been said, there were obviously various changes. In my own area of the law, one of the major changes was that the ultimate appeal court for Hong Kong became the Court of Final Appeal here in Hong Kong. Prior to 1997, if someone was aggrieved by a conviction or a sentence, they would have to take their case all the way to the Privy Council in London. And so very few people were able to do that. I mean, it's very expensive and it was difficult to get the necessary resources. But after 1997, because the Court of Final Appeal was based here in Hong Kong, it became far easier for people who were concerned about the outcome of cases to bring their appeals. So that was one change. Another change, of course, was that before 1997, there was very little democracy in Hong Kong. Indeed, when the joint declaration was signed between China and the United Kingdom in 1984, all the legislative councillors and executive councillors were appointed by the British governor. That changed dramatically after 1997. In the first elections that we had in 1998, 20 of the legislative councillors were elected by geographical constituencies, that's directly elected. And then by 2012, half of them were elected, 35 out of the 70. So that was a huge sea change. So going from very little democracy before 1997, within a fairly short period of time, 20 years or so, we'd achieved a situation whereby there was a huge degree of democratization. So these are the types of areas in which there were changes, but in other areas, fortunately, there was continuity. In my own particular area of public prosecutions, the system remained basically the same. When we decided whether to prosecute cases or not, we applied the same criteria, and we continued to use the traditions of the common law world. And indeed, the common law system remains underpinning the current legal system here in Hong Kong.
Why did you choose to stay in Hong Kong back in 40 years ago? And did you enjoy your life here in Hong Kong?
Well, I was working as a prosecutor in London, a very junior prosecutor, and I had an opportunity to come to Hong Kong initially for 2.5 years to work as a prosecutor here. So I came here, I enjoyed the way of life, I enjoyed the work I was doing. In fact, I was able to start doing very, very important cases at a very early age. If I'd stayed in England, those type of cases, murder cases, robbery cases, rape cases, I'd probably had to wait at least another 20 years. So it was immensely satisfying professionally. And in addition to which, I was immensely impressed by the Chinese people, their work ethic, and they were all very kind to me, which I very much appreciated. And so I decided to make my future here.
So what do you think Hong Kong's future lies in?
Well, quite clearly, Hong Kong is a global city, an important financial centre, a trading center, a legal center, which while retaining its global status, will increasingly play a role as China itself develops within the Greater Bay Area, and of course on the One World, One Belt, One Road initiative. We do have a highly developed legal system here, which inspires confidence around the world, particularly in the business community and amongst investors, and they very much appreciate the opportunities which Hong Kong is able to provide. In terms of its legal system, its judiciary, and its level playing field, which provides them with reassurance when they want to do business in the rest of China.
How many times have you been to Chinese mainland? What's the impression about China?
Well, I've travelled all over the Chinese mainland many, many times. I've been to all parts of the country, and I've been very impressed by the development in recent times. I mean, one of the reasons I have been a lot is to explain Hong Kong's legal system and its common law system and its prosecution system. And I've always found that people are very interested in how we do things in Hong Kong. And I've noticed that some of the developments which have taken place in China legally in recent times have actually reflected the experiences that we've had here in Hong Kong. So that has been gratifying to see that Hong Kong has been, China has been modernizing and taking account of legal developments, not only in Hong Kong, but in other places as well.
Okay, good. So, talking about Hong Kong's future, I think I'm going to invite another guest today.
Right.
So, he is the president of, yes, he's the, it's okay, yeah. He's the guest, he's the president of Yan DAB, and nor was she. Okay, so, just simple question. How do you think, where is Hong Kong's future in your mind?
I think Hong Kong's future would definitely lie with the rest of China. In the past, the Hong Kong was the central to the China business to open up to foreign investment and also other opportunities. So I think with the Greater Bay Area and with the development of China, Hong Kong will have lots of opportunities for, particularly for young people, to work, to study, and also to work their day-to-day life in China.
And at the beginning of the show, I said that we will tour a little bit about the West Kowloon Cultural District, including the Hong Kong Palace Museum, which will open next year. It's still under construction, but we can see a little bit more about the exhibition. So let's go now. Okay. So have you ever been to this Hong Kong Palace Museum before?
No, it's my first time. I've been to the Qing-dynasty the opera several times, but this is my first time to the cultural centre itself.
Okay.
So very much looking forward to the museum opening, because I've been to the Palace Museum in Beijing many times, and also the Palace Museum in Taipei many times. So it'll be wonderful to actually have the exhibits here for the first time. So we're all looking forward to that.
What's an impression about Palace Museum in Beijing. How many times have you been into Beijing?
Well, it's obviously an enormously interesting place. There's so many artifacts from the past, whether it's calligraphy or porcelain or relics of the various emperors. It's all fascinating to see, and it'd be very good that it'll be on hand or somewhere anyway for the local people here in Hong Kong to see as well.
Okay. Have you ever been to China's Palace Museum?
No, I not the mainland one, but I went to the Taipei one as well.
Okay. And about the Palace Museum, have you ever been to the? No, the Palace Museum will open soon. So, if you ever get the chance, any chance to. The museum yet?
Not yet, because it's opening next year, but I would love to, because I think museum is always a very good approach for people, like the general public, to know more about, you know, the history and the culture in a very interesting way, interactive way.
So, if this Hong Kong Palace Museum will open, I'm sure it will like show more Chinese culture to Hong Kong people, right? Especially the young people, I think. For many young Hong Kong people, they've never been to China before, right? This could be a chance for them to learn more about China's history and culture, right? So, okay, now we're here, and we're going to ask our one of the project managers here, please come over to help us introduce a little bit about this Hong Kong Palace Museum, okay? So, yeah.
So I think we're going to first start it with the model, right?
Yes. Okay.
Can you tell us a little bit more, So this is the model of the museum, and you will see there's a lot of open area, and it will connect to different part of the West Kowloon Zone.
那么整个大楼呢，它其实是一共七层高，那么里面包含了九个展厅，一共是7800平方米。
So there will be 7th floor, and that will have almost 80,000 square feet, and it will cover lots of different area.
对，刚刚说7800平方米呢，是说的是展厅的面积，展览厅的面积，它分了不同的种类，那么它除此之外呢，还有一些。 一些特别的在空间上的一些设计，包括我们几个大的中庭位置。那么整个结构看起来呢，也比较类似一个顶的造型。
So the design actually has a lot of mixture of the Hong Kong modern design, the Chinese art, and also the Chinese culture combined together.
对，我们可以看看那边的那个结构效果。 那么这个是它周边的一个环境的效果，可以看到它其实处在一个非常优美的地理位置，三面环海的这么一个环境之中。Yeah,
so the museum is surrounding by the harbor, the sea. So behind that, it's a Hong Kong skyline.
对，那么这边是它一个南面的一个立面图，可以很清楚地看到它这个外墙的里港以及它这个整个的一个效果。
Yeah, so this is the view from the south. So basically, from the park, where the public can walk around and take a rest. And you can see the construction of this, the metal, the metal construction of the buildings.
那这幅图呢，其实是它内部的一个演讲厅啊，这个演讲厅能容纳400人左右。
So this is the indoor, the main theater that can sit over 400 people.
对，所以这一个呢是它其中的一个中庭位置，这个高度呢，它的这个高度超过了12米。那么您看到这个天花的造型也是非常独特的，它其实是一个非常流线动感的这么一个设计理念。
So you can see this is the main area of the museum, like they have a lot of lateral sunlight coming in, and it's also 12 meter high, so it's a very big area.
And then let's look at that view.
对，可以看到这个是咱们的这个设计完成之后的一个动画效果。我们通过这一种叫 BIM 的技术，让它呈现出来它将来的这个设计的效果和感受，方便业主去了解、去观赏它这个。 状态.
Yeah, so this is an animation showing like what the future look would become like, and it can show like you can see all this kind of area and design inside the building, the interior.
对，您看到这个是一个大通砖的一个这么一个设计，它的采光整体的采光效果也是非常好。
So they mainly use the natural sunlight to go into the museum to create our very good area space and area feeling for the public.
Your impression about get this?
Well, it's very, very modernistic, isn't it? The latest styles, the latest fashion. But it's going to be a very interesting mix, I think. You'll have the very modern building, the very, very updated interiors on the one hand, and yet you'll have the historical artifacts on the other. So you'll be seeing the ceramics, I imagine, the porcelain, the clocks, the bronzes. All these very fascinating items in a very modern building. So I think that the local people, particularly the young children, will find it utterly fascinating.
Yeah. What's your impression about seeing this?
I think it's very nice. It's gonna be a great attraction point for lots of people, particularly young people, to come here to know more about Chinese history and get more understanding in a very interesting and proactive way.
Thank you so much. Hopefully this whole design, this whole Hong Kong Palace Museum and those exhibitions in the future will bring more people to come here to visit, right? And bring more Chinese culture elements into the education here in Hong Kong, right? As we all know that, I think for many young people in Hong Kong, they never went to Chinese mainland, some of them, and they don't really know about China, right? So hopefully this is a very good point for them to learn from China, okay? So for now, that's it for Hong Kong. And now I would head over to my colleague in Guangdong, Zhao Yunfei. Thank you so much. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.